Kom igjen nå, Silje. Kom igjen. Dette klarer du. Hello, it's Silje, and I hope you all are having a wonderful day. And welcome to Reading Week 1 of 2020. Today, I would like to talk about the books that I have been reading so far in January, and also what I'm currently reading, and maybe share some of my reading plans for next week. We'll see. But let's start with the books. January 1st, I actually read two books. The first one is a Norwegian new release, or 2019 release. This is De sju dørene by Agnes Ravatn. And she is the author of The Bird Tribunal, which is translated and is also one of my favorite Norwegian contemporaries. So I hope this one will be translated as well, because it is really good. This can be translated to The Seven Doors. So, yeah, that's that. This is a mystery. It's about literature. It's about fairy tales, or fairy tales is intertwined with the story, and especially how you can interpret fairy tales. And we meet Nina, who is a professor in literature at the University of Bergen. She is married. I don't recall the name of her husband, but he is a physician, now turned politician, and he is a member of the city council. They also have a daughter who is also a physician, and let's just say that Nina and her daughter has quite a bad relationship. And I am a sucker for bad mother-daughter relationships, and this book deals with at least two. So of course I am happy. Nina and her husband has a tenant, a young woman with a child. She is quite mysterious, and when she goes missing, Nina starts to investigate her disappearance. And while doing so, she stumbled across dark secrets and things that people don't want to be exposed. This book has some of the dark and bleakness that you could find in The Bird Tribunal, but it is at the same time completely different. One thing that stood out to me, is that Ravatn has kept her snarky and sharp and ironic tongue in this one, or pen in this one. This is something she is very well known for in her essays, and when she wrote The Bird Tribunal, she had to take all of that out of the text. So this has more humor, but it is on the dark side. And the writing is phenomenal. It's written in the most beautiful new Norwegian, and the pacing is great, the plot is interesting, and I just flew through the pages in one day. Yeah, as I said, I do hope that this will be translated, because it is such a great book. The next two books that I read were in this bind-up, and that is 84 Charing Cross Road, and also the sequel, The Duchess of Bloomsbury Street by Helene Hanff. I read the first one as a read-along hosted by Sarah at Hardcover Hearts on January 1st, and it is a reread for me. And it is so cool to just stumble across my own notes like this, and I had completely forgotten about this. But this first book is about the mail correspondence between Helene Hanff, a young writer in New York, and the people at Marks & Co. Booksellers in 84 Charing Cross Road in London. And it spans over 20 years, and it starts in 1949 when Helene wants a certain book, and she writes to this bookseller, and that is the beginning of a 20-year-long friendship, not just between her and Frank Doler, who is the person she is most in touch with, but also with the other people at the bookshop and also their family. And I love Helene Hanff, and I love her voice, and she is so snarky and witty and curious, but she also has this enormous warm heart. And this is about books and book lovers, it's about literature, and it's most of all about friendship. And yeah, a wonderful, wonderful revisit. The sequel to 84 Charing Cross Road is called The Duchess of Bloomsbury Street, and it's set in 1971 when Helene is going to London for the first time. Her book 84 Charing Cross Road has been a major success in the US and are now being released in the UK, and she is invited to the release. And this is her diary about those weeks and all the people she meets. She meets all the remaining people from the bookshop and their families, and she meets up with a wide range of other people as well, and it's pure delight to read about. And I really enjoyed how she was describing streets and neighborhoods that I also have been visiting. So yeah, it's just a delight. Beautiful, beautiful book. I'm glad I both reread the first one and continuing with the second one. Highly recommend it. Then I also read the fourth volume of Ice Cream Man by W.Maxwell Prince, Martin Morazzo, Chris O'Halloran. And yeah, I love this series, and this was no letdown. It is as amazing as all the others. There are four stories in this one, and in the third volume, we went to some other dimensions and other times. Now we are back in the suburbs, and the Ice Cream Man doesn't play as important part in these stories, but he is, as always, in the background doing stuff. The first one is called Palindrome, and it's about a man who has lost his partner, and he is setting out on this very absurd trip down the sewer to meet the Lord of the Underground. And one thing that I really liked about this book is that it's written like a palindrome. So you can read it, you can start from the beginning or start from the end, and the story will be the same. And that means that when you are halfway in this chapter, you will meet the same panels again and the same dialogue, but it's told in the opposite order. And that makes this book very cool, I think, because it both shows us this descent into the sewer and into the madness that is in this sewer, but it also shows him raising up again. So in some way, this ends with some kind of hope, a tiny, tiny slice of hope, which I find to be quite unusual in an Ice Cream Man story. But yeah, it deals with loss, and it deals with how to come to terms with what has happened. And it's very good. I think it is my favorite in this collection. The next story is called Down and Across. This deals with relationships, about feeling lonely in a relationship and not being able to communicate what is difficult. It's very bleak, and it turns into this claustrophobic and paranoid horror story. But at the same time, like the first one, I feel like there is some glimpse of hope here. I'm not sure. Maybe I'm just being fooled. But yeah, I feel like there is some glimpses of hope here as well. One thing that I very much enjoyed with this one was the exploration of the relationship between the couple and how what they are not able to say to each other is told through words in a crossword. I think this is a genius way to tell a story. And yeah, it's quite awesome. The next is Code Check Story. I do think this is my least favorite. Not because it's a bad story, it is not. I think it's pretty solid. But it didn't capture me in the same way like the others did. But it is like this descent into madness. We are following the main character Lillian. In the beginning, she is at the institution. And then we go back and we learn how she ended up there. And it's very chaotic. I think it's a good way to show how you can really lose it. It's this mysterious boy with a red balloon. It's a finger, and we have this mysterious coat. So yeah, I don't have a lot to say about it. I enjoyed it, but it's not my favorite. The last one is Tiny Lives, and this one is really heartbreaking. It's about a father who is a single parent of a daughter, and he decides to read her diary. And at first it is pretty innocent, but it quickly takes a very dark turn. And it's about fatherhood, it's about loss of innocence, and it's about the ultimate sacrifice. And it's so, so sad and so disturbing, and yet I loved it. So yeah, this was such a great reading experience. I highly recommend you to check out Ice Cream Man. It is one of my favorite graphic novels. It's brilliant. Sheer brilliance. I am currently reading Anne of Green Gables for the Analong. This is written by Lucy M. Montgomery, and it's a reread for me, and it's just a delight being back in Avonlea and Green Gables and meeting all these characters that I truly love. So yeah, I will be continuing reading this next week. And hopefully I will get to some other books as well. I hope to get to Pedro, Paramo by Juan, Rulfo, and also Agnes by Peter Stamm for Read German Lit. Peter Stamm is a Swiss author, but he writes in German. And this is Miriam at Between Lines and Life's favorite novel. And I have been meaning to read this for ages. So hopefully next week will be the perfect time. That was my first reading week of the year. Please let me know in the comments if you have read any of these books or what you have been reading this week. I would love to know. And yeah, until next time. Ha det!